Judd Snow Jeffries, Professor of African American and African Studies at The Ohio State University.
Thank you. And in broad strokes, could you describe the social and political landscape of the early 1970s?
Oh, wow. Okay, the early political landscape of the 1970s. If I could encapsulate that, I would say the early 1970s were an extension of the 1960s. In other words, when you think about 1970, 1971, and 1972, the events that unfolded in those three years alone, you could fill an entire decade. The 3 years were exhilarating, tumultuous, dynamic, and exhausting all at the same time.
And can you expound on that a little bit?
Okay, so when I think about the early 1970s, in terms of for Black folks, there was a lot to rejoice about, and of course, there was a lot of despair. So, man, oh man. We talk about the disproportionate number of Black men who were coming home in body bags as a result of the Vietnam War in 1970. And then, of course, in 1971, you have like three major events, starting off with probably the induction of Leroy Satchel Paige into the Hall of Fame, being the first African-American inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame. You go from there to the fight, which was billed as the fight of the century, heard around the world between Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier, the first time ever that two African-American heavyweights who were undefeated squared off each other for the heavyweight championship of the world. And then, of course, later on in the year, you have something that was very disconcerting, that being the uprising that took place in the prison in Attica, New York, where more than three dozen people were killed, including some correctional officers.
Okay, so then to get a little more specific, could you describe Nixon's grant of law and order and his appeal to the so-called silent majority? And talk a little bit about how the Nixon administration's policies towards groups engaged in political protests affected Black political movements. And so I'm thinking of forceful prosecution, enhanced surveillance, the inception of no-knock warrants, and RICO.
Yeah. Excellent question. So let me debunk some myths and unravel some misunderstandings about the Nixon administration. So there's this conventional wisdom that has Richard Nixon promulgating this idea of law and order during his re-election campaign. Not true. Nixon was always touting law and order. As early as his first presidential campaign, that he lost against Jack Kennedy in 1960. The idea of law and order was featured prominently in his campaign in 1968. The other thing, so we see when we think about the proliferation of Americans in the country's jails and prisons, right? We often lay that at the doorstep of Richard Nixon coming into office. Yes and no. Who gets left off the hook is Governor Nelson Rockefeller in New York, who, along with Nixon, conferenced, caucused, and kibitzed together, coming up with this three strikes, you're out, no-knock warrants, which resulted in the slaughtering of inmates and correctional officers in Attica. The result of Nixon being in office, though, resulted in a level of political repression against groups that were comprised of the Black Power Movement and the New Left. Resulted in a level of political repression that the United States of America had not seen in over 50 years. Even today, when you look at the folk who considered themselves activists and revolutionaries, when you look at the number of people who are in jail, you would be surprised to learn of the disproportionate number of folk who were members of the Republican New Africa, the Black Panther Party, and if you look at the white left, SDS, and of course, the Weather Underground. So Nixon's administration ushered in a level of political repression that was basically unprecedented. Also, perhaps the most widely documented incident of police repression under the Nixon administration took place on the west side of Chicago that resulted in the assassination of Deputy Chairman of the Illinois State Chapter of the Black Panther Party, Fred Hampton, and Defense Captain Mark Clark from Peoria. I have been arguing that Nixon's election to the presidency not only ushered in a level of unprecedented political repression against the left and the Black Power Movement, but made Americans accustomed to coming down hard on those who sought to challenge the status quo. And it did so in a fashion where it's widely documented now, but not then, that the Nixon administration, right, curried favor with members of the media, folk in the Washington Post, folk in the LA Times, folk in the New York Times, in such a way where it had reporters on the White House's payroll with the express purpose of characterizing activists who were only interested in getting the United States of America to live up to the ideals as expressed in its three most sacrosanct documents, the Bill of Rights, Declaration of Independence, United States Constitution, to get them to live up what they wrote on paper. Nixon got reporters to characterize them in a way that painted them as unpatriotic, making it easier for law enforcement to come in and squash them.
Second, here, Celia. I have one concern I want to share with both, hopefully, Scott's in earshot. Right, we've set it up always so that when you, because you're looking right at Celia, I can see you in the video. Hopefully, the camera is set up so it looks like you're looking right at it or right close to it. That's what I expect, but I didn't want to fail to check.
Scott said yes. I asked him about that. Scott said yes.
Thank you. All right, we're rolling again.
Okay.
Sure. Thanks, Alan. Could you just talk in broad strokes about
the silent majority was, and if you see any parallels to any groups existing in this country today? Oh, the silent majority. Hey, the silent majority then is exactly who Dr. Martin Luther King said it was. It was an overwhelming majority of white folks who stood idly by and allowed the state to come in and squash people of African descent. Now, one of my students asked me if I saw any parallels between yesteryear and today. And my answer to that was, fortunately, while I believe a silent majority still exists, the silent majority is less robust these days than it was in previous decades. Never before have we seen the numbers of white people take to the streets and challenge the state in the manner that we've seen over the past year and a half. You look at cities like Vancouver, Washington, which is lily white. You look at the city of Portland, which has a black population of like less than 5%. When you look at the folk who are participating in those protests, easily 70 to 80 to 90% white. We've never seen the level of white participation in these protests, or if you want to call them rebellions or uprisings, we've never seen this level of white participation on behalf of someone black who was killed by a white police officer. We've never seen that before, so it's promising. But there is still a silent majority. It's just not as robust in 2020 and 2021 as it was in 1971. So the objective on the part of the state is to consign people of African descent to an inferior place in society, then and now. There's no significant difference across eras. That's the purpose. I have told students of mine who fashion themselves to be revolutionaries and activists, I've made it clear to them that there are no limits to which the state, or no limits to which the state will go to squash you if they deem you to be a threat to America's way of life. And I've given them countless examples. So for any young person who says to him or herself, oh, okay, hey, listen, so my interest is, let's say, overturning the government and starting anew. So in my class, I talk about the fact that, hey, listen, Thomas Jefferson, one of the central founding fathers, said that, hey, listen, rebellion, and more specifically, revolution was a good thing, that perhaps rebellions and revolutions should take place every 10 or 20 years. In fact, and I quote, he said, hey, listen, when the government starts to behave antithetical to the people's interests, the people have a right to overthrow it and begin anew. Well, some of my students have taken that literally. And I've said to them, while that's commendable and laudable, just realize that if you portray yourself that way, not only will you come under surveillance, but you will be the victims of a level of political repression that you've only seen in the movie. So I've made that very clear. That if you're going to be an activist, that there's a way to be an activist in 2021. You can learn from the mistakes of the young people who were activists in 1961, 1971, and perhaps Black Lives Matter, who, as you know, have made it a point not to promulgate the idea of having leaders of their movement as opposed to having a movement that, I guess, moves based on collective decision-making as opposed to having someone out front, which would make it easy for the state to target that person. So I say all of that to say being clandestine has its place in 2021, even more so than 1971. Death. J. Edgar Hoover made it very clear in the late 1960s and early 1970s that any young person willing or aspiring to be a revolutionary would do so at their own peril. that at the end of the day, right, that if they were interested in challenging the status quo or overthrowing the government, we would have a lot of dead revolutionaries in the United States of America. Because, you know, the thing about the late 1960s and early 1970s, people when they think of the activism that was unfolding across the United States of America, they think of activists who were full-fledged adults. But as someone who's been studying this since the late 1980s, I can tell you with a great deal of certainty that the overwhelming majority of activists, especially within the African American community, right, were basically kids, teenagers, and then in their early 20s. I go back to Fred Hampton. I mean, Fred Hampton was 20, right? Mark Clark was 21, right? Yet the Cook County State's Attorney and the FBI, right, were not reticent about snuffing out the lives of basically two kids. So I have to remind students of that all the time. The youth back in 1971, hey, listen, if you remember, so between 1966 and 1970, the country had experienced more upheaval during those several years than in the previous 100 years in terms of urban uprisings. Well, the state, right, the state used those urban uprisings as an excuse to come in and ravage black communities. And if they had to kill someone in the process, well, that was just a byproduct of good policing. And the overwhelming majority of white folks bought it because, again, the state and the media, and some folk like to consider the media part of the state, hence the reason the media is referred to as the fourth estate, right? The media, when they covered these uprisings, they mislabeled them by calling them riots, right? An outbreak of violence that's frivolous, that's lacking in political purpose, right? That is illegitimate, right? Carried out by people whose claims are erroneous. So they labeled them riots, and as we know, the word riot conjures up certain images. So when the electronic media broadcast riots, you hear vernacular like pandemonium, stampeding, herd-like, and the races among them will refer to things like zoo and monkeys. What they don't do is provide readers, listeners, and viewers with context to explain why the people in these cities elected to erupt. And we all know that they elected to erupt because they've had legitimate grievances that they've tried to get rectified, only to be ignored and dismissed. They've worked through conventional channels, and the uprising is their last resort. So the state, meaning law enforcement, worked together with media, right? They couched this violence in the form of riots. By doing that, right, because most Americans are sheep then and now, it resonated with whites that blacks were barbaric, violent criminals. All they wanted was a free toaster oven or a couch, as opposed to, listen, there are real issues in the African-American community that we need addressed, that if addressed will benefit everyone. Instead of seeing it like this, they saw blacks as less than human. So when the state came in and squashed them, there was no empathy or sympathy, and it allowed them to turn a blind eye in their minds in good conscience.
Oh,
Oh, okay. So, yeah, let me set the record straight on the origins of the police. Because there's this widely held conventional thinking that police originated as slave patrols. Yes and no. Idea of policing, first of all, came from London and Sir Robert Peel, right? But when police departments were first formed in the United States of America in the 1800s, the first two police departments were New York and Boston. Obviously, those are not necessarily slave states. So the police departments that were formed, or police forces that were formed in the South, were formed originally, right, to apprehend runaway slaves and the like. Not so in the North. The police departments that were formed in the North were basically formed to keep the have-nots, to keep the haves safe from the have-nots, whether they be black, white, or so on. Now, in terms of the police being a tool of political repression, when did that intensify? So I argue that the militarization specifically of the police, which has been a widely discussed topic in the last several years, was not something that happened recently, but was something that was really born, I would argue, in the city of Los Angeles in the mid-1960s, which was considered the most prestigious police department in the world at that time, the LAPD. I'm not exactly sure how they define prestigious, but nonetheless, the militarization of police departments started in Los Angeles, and it started with one principal actor, and that was Daryl Gates. Daryl Gates, who climbed the ranks of the police department in Los Angeles, came up with this idea in the mid-60s called SWAT, Special Weapons and Tactics, right? At that particular time, he wasn't the police chief. I think it was Police Chief Thomas Redding, but I'm not sure. In any event, he went to his police chief and he said, "Hey, listen, I have an idea," and it was called something like Special Weapons and Artillery Task Force. And the police chief said, "No, we can't have anything named like that in the city of Los Angeles. Go back and find a new name." He came back with Special Weapons and Tactics, and the reason why Mr. Gates came up with this is because a year or so earlier, right, the United States had experienced the worst uprising of the 20th century in Watts, right? So the Los Angeles Police Department was wholly ill-prepared to deal with what took place on the city streets of Watts. Daryl Gates said, "Okay, I think I can remedy that," came up with SWAT. Police departments got wind of this. The next thing you know, police officials started converging on the city of Los Angeles to witness what he had put in place. Then the next thing you know, Daryl Gates is making presentations all across the United States of America, such that in 2021, even small town police departments now have SWAT, whereas before only the major police departments had SWAT. So all of this points directly at the Los Angeles Police Department, more specifically, Daryl Gates. This is also during a period where a relationship is being formed between police departments and the FBI, right? So police officers are being sent for extra training, right, in Quantico, where the FBI trains its officers, right? And FBI agents are going to places like Los Angeles, right, and being trained in aspects of urban guerrilla warfare. So it's very interesting. It's very interesting.
Mm-hmm. Now that you say that, everything makes perfect sense. So if I did not provide you with full context.
That's okay.
Essentially, at Linda McKinley High School in 1931, so I'm going to back up a little bit. In the years preceding that, there were profound demographic shifts in the Linden community, whereas it was had been primarily white, and it became, you know, there was an influx of black residents to that community, which of course was reflected in the population of the high school. And there was tension that came up around that, and there was definitely a sense on the part of white students of being replaced, being shut out of a lot of the extracurricular activities, specifically athletics and music, and just an increased presence of black students at the school, and a group of black students who call themselves the Black Student Union, who were activists, who wanted to have equitable conditions for themselves as students. They wanted the school, instead of having portraits of all white people, they wanted the school to reflect their presence. They wanted to have a level of education that was that they felt they were entitled to, which they were, of course. And so in that year, in that school year, there was an increased presence, police presence at the school repeatedly, and there were, and there was a sort of culminated in a pretty big police raid that came in response to, well, there were a couple of things that happened. There was a Black History Week performance that was put on. It was an all-school assembly. And during that, a white student went to the balcony and dumped flyers over the balcony onto the audience in the middle of the performance. And the flyers were basically rants about, you know, white students not having a place anymore. And they were racist and derogatory. And then there was an incident later in that school year in the spring where black students replaced the American flag with the Black National flag. And there were multiple occasions where police were dispatched to the school. One particular time in riot gear, and there were students who were assaulted by police. There were teachers who were trying to protect students. It was chaotic, pandemonium, and it was traumatic for the students. So with that being said, I want to ask you, given the things that had happened recently on other campuses, does that police raid at Linda McKinley High School, does that surprise you? And what do you think the level of danger was, to potential danger, to the students?
Oh, to the Black students? Heck no, it doesn't surprise me. Hey, listen. What took place at Linda McKinley High School, right, was in the context of a larger movement that was taking place all across the United States of America from 1968, 1969, 70, 71, 72. There were demonstrations taking place not only on college campuses, right, but in high schools all across the United States of America, starting with probably the largest student demonstration, which was in California in the late 1960s. What took place at Linda McKinley, right, was in the larger context of what was taking place in the United States of America. Hey, listen, that same year that Linda McKinley erupted, you had the largest demonstration of people against the Vietnam War in the entire doggone decade of the 60s and the 70s. That demonstration that took place in Washington, D.C., well, actually, there was two. You had a demonstration that took place in Washington, D.C., where there was about 500,000 people. Then that same year, you had a demonstration that took place in San Francisco of over 100,000 people. Meanwhile, there are kids demonstrating and walking out of high schools all across the United States of America. And the reason why I'm focusing in on high schools, not just because Lyndon McKinley is the focus of this particular discussion, but because when we talk about demonstrations, student strikes, and walkouts, history tends to privilege that which took place on college campuses. And I'm saying young folk in high school and indeed junior high school played an enormous role in the activities that unfolded in the United States of America. So around this time, this was probably, if memory serves me correctly, this was probably the time when the majority of Americans were coming to their senses and realizing that there was very little chance of the United States of America emerging victorious out of the Vietnam War movement. Because if I'm not mistaken, the Harris poll that year concluded that 60% of all Americans were now in opposition to the Vietnam War, and that wasn't the case in previous years when polls were taken. And obviously, I'm going to argue that a disproportionate number of folk who had opposed the Vietnam War were college and high school students. No, so it didn't surprise me. Didn't surprise me at all. It fit well what was taking place in the United States of America at that time. Kent State, 1970, with four kids being fatally wounded, right? You had what is not given the attention it deserves at the Ohio State University, right? The large student demonstration that took place in 1970, right? In conjunction with the largest student protest and demonstration in the world, in places like Mexico City, in places like Czechoslovakia, in places like Prague, right? Students all over the world, now obviously they didn't have cell phones, right? They didn't have email. So how in the world they were able to coordinate that across the entire globe, right? I mean, this was an important part of what was taking place during that period. Okay, there was another part of that question that I forgot. What was that? That was the last part of that question. No, I think I missed something.
You know what? I think I added the last part to that question, so we may have missed it. I was asking if it surprised you, and...
Oh, I know what I want to mention. So, Professor Ross, I want to talk a little bit about, if I can, I want to talk a little bit about how he saw his role as the... Director of Black Studies at the Ohio State University, and how it came to be that he ended up exerting his influence and participating in a rally and demonstration at Lyndon McKinley. So I think it's pretty much well known now that Black Studies at the Ohio State University came about in 1969. Black Studies, the Black Studies Division. In 1972, the Black Studies Division became a department, and then in 1975 it secured the first master's program in Black Studies. Professor Ross is hired as the first director. The reason why he's hired as the first director is because, according to Dr. Nelson, Dr. Nelson saw him as a stand-up guy, saw him as someone who was radical-minded, and saw him as someone who didn't smile in the presence of whites, didn't dance where there was no music, and didn't scratch where there was no itch. So Dr. Nelson and others thought he would be a good fit. Professor Ross saw his role not as someone who was merely a professor of Black Studies, but if a person was going to be a professor of Black Studies, that meant that they were going to have to take Black Studies to the community, right? And part of taking Black Studies to the community means, hey, listen, advocating on people's behalf who are interested in enhancing the life chances of people of African descent. So he saw this as not only a way to sort of advertise the kind of mission that Black Studies has, but he saw this as a way of making his presence known in the African American community as the director of Black Studies. If you remember, he was the result of police violence. People like to talk a great deal about the police presence that the students encountered, but Professor Ross was the was on the other end of a police baton. He ended up getting arrested, and some folk don't give Professor Ross the credit that he deserves in that his role in that protest gave Black Studies more press coverage than it probably would have gotten, easily than it probably would have gotten had he just remained on campus, which is what most Black professors did then and now. So I just want to make that clear.
Thank you very much. We definitely appreciate that. I want to ask you to talk a little bit about youth political activism. One thing I want to ask you is, do you think that American youth in previous decades, particularly the 60s and 70s, were more politically active than youth in later decades? Why or why not? And then, as a second part of it, do you think it's fair to say that there's been a resurgence of youth political activism in the United States?
It's promising. It's promising. It's very promising. Do I think that young folk were more politically active in the 1960s than 1970s? Absolutely. And I don't even think it's close. And the reason why it's not close, because you had a war that basically took place for the better part of a decade, right? And a lot of the activism revolved around that. And a lot of people came to politically maturity during that era, right? Their consciousness was raised during that era. So for instance, when you talk about the Ohio State University and the bringing about Black Studies, it took a vast coalition to bring that about. It wasn't just Black students, right? But as Professor Paul Cook, who was a student at the Ohio State University at the time, made it clear to me, say, listen, Brother Jeffries, we had a large coalition of people, right? People of different colors, genders. We had some folk who were veterans. But at the end of the day, we made it clear that, hey, listen, while we also want to bring about the end of the Vietnam War, right, that no issue would take precedent over the fact that what we're interested in is bringing about a curriculum that is a more accurate reflection of our geographical, historical, political, and social heritage, and that being Black Studies. So while you had white students and veterans who may have thought that bringing about Black Studies was a good idea, right, their main interest was bringing an end to the war, and all of these groups of people got together and said, okay, we have some common interests, right? Let's move in the same direction, right? We can achieve our common interests, but let's move in the same direction. And when we get Black Studies, then we'll help you get Women's Studies. When we help you get Women's Studies, then we'll help you get Latino Studies, and so forth and so on. Do I see a resurgence? I do see a resurgence, but the cause for the resurgence, I think, is different. So back then, right, it was the Vietnam War. Now, it's police brutality. And again, never before have we seen the tremendous number of whites get involved in this issue like we've seen in the last couple of years. It's almost as if there is a new generation. You know, I'm tempted to say that there's a new generation of white people, but I stop myself because when I see footage of these demonstrations. So for instance, I have a friend who lives in Portland who founded the Portland branch of the Black Panther Party in 1969. Every single night, he was sending me footage of demonstrations in which he was participating in. And easily the crowd was like 90% white. And you had young folk, but you had older folk and you had some old fogies. You had white women with signs saying moms. You had older white women. We'd never seen this before. On behalf of someone who was killed by a white police officer. Now, folk want to argue with me all the time and say, Dr. Jeffries, we've seen significant numbers of white folk protesting on behalf of black folk. And they say, hey, listen, look at the modern civil rights movement or look at the March on Washington. I said, we have, but not on the issue of police brutality, right? It's almost as if some white folks are saying that what we have been seeing via these cell phone warriors, folk who are brave enough to stand and film police officers, it's almost as if there are significant numbers of whites who are saying, you know, even I can't turn a blind eye to this kind of egregious, barbaric behavior, lest I become complicit in the murder of the person who was just killed. We've never seen that before. So I'm thinking that there is a segment of the white community who are saying no longer should racism be a cross that blacks have to bear by themselves, right? We need to join this fight. And I'm thinking that some of them have gotten so hip to the fact that even though, right, white police officers, when they snuff out a black life, historically, police officers didn't get charged. DAs and prosecutors, right, had cozy relationships with police officers historically, so police officers didn't get charged, let alone seeing the inside of a jail cell. Now that's changing incrementally. It's changing incrementally, right? But now what we're seeing, right, now what we're seeing whites who I believe have gotten hip and have said to themselves, you know what? Police officers are still not being charged and sentenced to jail at the rate at which we would like them to be. But perhaps we better join this fight, because while they're not being charged and sentenced, what happens is the city ends up paying these huge settlements. And these hundreds of thousands of dollars and these millions of dollars come out of our pocketbooks, our tax dollars. And in some cities, I think some politically sophisticated citizens, black, white, and whoever, have realized that some cities actually, and this is egregious as far as I'm concerned, they actually factor into the city's budget, right? Police malfeasance, right? Predicting that police are going to behave badly, and as a result, the city will be forced to pay out these settlements. So I think what we're seeing is indeed a resurgence. I don't think it has reached the levels of the 1960s and the 1970s, right? I do think the reasons for the resurgence, the reasons are different, right? But what I'm seeing is nonetheless promising. Nonetheless promising.
Dr. Jeffries, I wonder if you could, just to kind of bring this full circle, if you could speak to any parallels that you see between those kids, the Black Student Union at Linda McKinley High School, and young black people who are demonstrating, who have been demonstrating and are in recent years and in, you know, in today. And why is their exercise of their political voices so fraught? And why does it matter? Why does it matter that black youth make their voices heard today?
Oh, I mean,
does it matter?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Absolutely it matters, because at the end of the day, oftentimes change is brought about by the young. There's no way on this God's green earth, that the Vietnam War would have ended without teenagers and folk in their young 20s pressuring the government to bring those soldiers home and put an end to the assault in Southeast Asia. Oftentimes, when we talk about unconventional change, meaning change being brought about by folk who take to the streets, oftentimes those people are young folk. Then and now, although, as I mentioned before, I'm very encouraged by the fact that not only am I seeing young folk take to the streets, but I'm seeing older and older folk take to the streets. If we want to see the United States live up to those sacrosanct ideals as expressed in the Declaration of Independence, United States Constitution, and the Bill of Rights, change is probably going to be brought about by folk who would be considered the young people of this generation. I want to mention something else about the Lyndon McKinley thing, right? So one thing we need folk to understand is that the Lyndon McKinley event took place during an era that we call the Black Power Movement. Now, the reason why I'm hopping on that is because when most people think about the Black Power Movement, they think about the 1960s, but the Black Power Movement went well into the 1970s. So the kind of ruckus that we saw, right, at that high school was indicative of the way that Black people were expressing themselves from the mid-60s into the 1970s. And what I mean by that is that Black folks were expressing themselves in ways that we hadn't really seen Black folk comport themselves. Black folk were being bolder, more brazen, more aggressive, and more assertive. And that was expressed not only in the political activism of the day, but it was expressed in the culture, it was expressed in the music, right? So when we think about the music, I mean, Lyndon McKinley took place in 1971. We can't really talk about the activism that took place at Lyndon McKinley in 71 and the activism that was unfolding across the United States of America, especially in Black communities, without talking about, Gil Scott-Heron. I mean, you can't talk about that era without talking about his first studio album, Pieces of a Man, on which the iconic song "The Revolution Will Not Be Televised" was featured promptly. You can't talk about that year without talking about The Last Poets, right? And I always tell my students, hey, listen, right? Don't come to me talking about rap music unless you can talk to me about The Last Poets. If you can't talk to me about The Last Poets, then sit back and let me drop some science on you about rap, right? So you had The Last Poets, right? And that 1971 film called Right On, which featured the radical and revolutionary work of the last poets. Then, of course, you had Marvin Gaye's What's Going On, right? So, and then that comes on the heels of 1969, James Brown, who I consider, hey, listen, who provided the anthem for the Black Power Movement, and I'm Black and I'm Proud. So all of this, so Lyndon McKinley, what took place, what unfolded on that high school campus, right, fits nicely in what was taking place in the United States of America at that time and how Black folk were more brazen, more assertive, more aggressive than they had been in previous, years, right? And of course, all of that kind of finds its origins in the way that Malcolm X, the Honorable Minister Malcolm X, talked about how we needed to think for ourselves, and how our thinking needed to be totally reprogrammed, and what we saw at Lyndon McKinley was like an outgrowth of what Minister Malcolm X had been talking about in the years leading up to his assassination.
Thank you. like to ask you, in closing, if you, what do you have to say to Black youth today? And what do you see as the best way forward? The most hopeful way forward, the most productive way forward?
Yeah. So, in terms of the most productive way forward, I don't think I want to put that on camera, because at the end of the day, Black folks are under an assault, and my interests are thus: as a college professor, I'm interested in doing whatever I can to dismantle sexism and racism, right? Those are two ills which I'm primarily interested in eradicating as a college professor. As a Black man, I'm interested in, coming up with ways in which we can mitigate against police officers coming into the Black community and snuffing out Black lives, right? So years ago, in 1966, when an organization that called itself the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense was found in Oakland, Eldridge Cleaver, who joined the Black Panther Party a year or two later, said, hey, listen, that one of the reasons why we came up with the idea to patrol the police is because the police would come into the African-American community and occupy it like a foreign army. So the message we wanted to send to the police was, you will no longer come into the Black community and snuff out Black lives indiscriminately. The next time you come into the Black community with the idea of taking a life, you're going to have to bring ass to get ass. That's what Eldridge Cleaver said. So now, at the end of the day, while I realize that the issue of Black-on-Black crime is serious, I realize that, right? I don't think anyone with any sense who's of African descent would dismiss that as being an important social ill, no doubt. But what's also important to me is sending a message. What that message would look like, I don't know, but sending a message to this state that we aren't going to sit back and allow state agents to come in our communities and ravage them by killing off a generation of Black men and women. And we aren't going to wait for the state to do something to ameliorate that problem. So when I'm asked, yeah, what's the most productive way going forward? Yeah, I don't want to put my ideas on tape. For young folk, what I would say to them is something. Yeah, what I would say to them is, at the end of the day, especially folk who are going to Ohio State and these other prestigious campuses, college campuses, what I would say is, hey, listen. So, in my classes, what I say is, I want you to, once you graduate, to put your degree to work in such a way where you're enhancing the life chances of folk who don't have or who haven't had the opportunities you had, in whatever community that may be. So I want you to go about changing the world one person at a time. So what I've recently been doing, especially for my students, and I get hordes of them, especially for my students who want to become lawyers, and I say, listen, look, I know you are in love with the idea of becoming a corporate lawyer and being rich and famous and having a house in Beverly Hills. I know that appeals to you. But I would like to urge you to, when you go to law school, have in your mind that you want to become a DA, right? Or even a prosecutor. And have in your mind that, hey, listen, you want to matriculate to being a judge. Because at the end of the day, this problem of police brutality, which I argued in 2000 in the Journal of Harvard, the Harvard Journal of African American Public Policy, I said, hey, listen, this is a public crisis. And it's even worse now than it was then. I was under the impression, hey, once that video of Rodney King got circulated, once that video of Rodney King being brutally and savagely beaten by four LAPD officers, while several CHP officers, California Highway Patrol officers, stood by, once that video got circulated around the world, I thought that this was going to cause police officers across the United States of America to be on their P's and Q's. And boy, was I wrong. Right, you have police officers in the case of Mr. Chauvin who saw that he was being videotaped, never ordered any of his guys, hey, listen, block that camera. He didn't try to obscure himself. He didn't try to hide, right, or hunk down. He looked directly into the camera. And what was he saying? He was saying, oh, okay, so for all of you who supported Colin Kaepernick and his kneeling, right? Let me really show you how to kneel. This is how to kneel. How do you like this kneeling? Right? And I'm gonna do it until life seeps out of this guy's body. We saw for the first time involving an incident of police use of excessive force, we saw life leave George Floyd's body on TV, right? So what I say to my kids is, I say, hey, listen, I want you to become part of the system. I don't want you to go out there and, you know, take up revolutionary action and all that kind of stuff you saw in the 1960s, because the result of that is prison or death, right? Now, unless you are willing to spend the rest of your life in prison, right? And unless you're willing to be carried by six and not judged by 12, then what I'm asking you to do is to go conventional and try to change the system from within. Become judges, become DAs, become prosecutors.